Coming debate, the Honourable Member for Davenport.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. And I'm grateful to have the opportunity to speak on Bill C-10, the government's so-called Safe Streets and Communities Act. Indeed, of the many ways in which the Conservative government is moving Canada backwards, few initiatives do more to achieve this than Bill C-10. In my riding at Davenport over the last 2 years, this is one of the issues that has come up most often. Concern over this government's obsession with spending billions of dollars and compelling, by the way, the provinces to do the same towards a crime bill that will largely not make our streets any safer and won't contribute to building stronger communities. You know, I live in a riding where in the last 2 years we've seen schools close, recreation centers close, daycare centers close, programs to help settle new immigrants have been gutted. Bus routes, used primarily by folks doing shift work, have been cut, and seniors in dire need of new investments, senior services that are in dire need of new investments. Now, I live in a city where 70,000 people are on a waiting list for affordable housing. So while the essential services that are needed to create strong, vibrant, safe streets and communities are being choked, this government can find billions upon billions of dollars for an experiment on crime prevention, which has failed in every jurisdiction where it's been attempted, utterly failed, as we know, in the United States. Now, don't get me wrong. It isn't that people in my riding aren't concerned about crime. They are concerned about crime. Indeed, they are. But I am reminded of a conversation I had with some residents who were concerned about drug dealers taking over the local park. And I'm concerned about that, too. Now, it wasn't that they were just concerned about the dealers. To a person, these residents complained not so much that there aren't enough prisons to lock these dealers up, but there aren't enough programs for young people to get involved in, that with nothing to do and few local job prospects, young people are vulnerable to falling into gang culture and criminal elements. Bill C-10 does not address this fundamental, foundational issue around crime prevention. Now, while I listed all the closures in my riding, and I could list more, in fact, Madam Speaker, there are things that are being built and opened in my riding, and in the riding of Davenport, there are two brand new police stations being built as we speak. Now, many are hopeful, as am I, that these new police stations in our neighborhoods will help with some of the crime issues that people are dealing with. But the problem underlined in my riding is writ large in Bill C-10. There is no balance here. In communities across this country, investment in social infrastructure is desperately needed, yet we are told that we are heading into a period of austerity and that there's no money, Madam Speaker. Well, there is money for some things, but when ideology trumps common sense, you get nasty pieces of legislation like Bill C-10. Instead of a national affordable housing strategy that would provide a framework to provide stable, affordable housing, a key determinant to health and a primary building block for safe communities, this government will spend over $500 million this year alone on new prison construction. This is their housing strategy for Canada. And while this government squeezes middle and working class families and small businesses, they are happy to spend over $162,000 on average annually for each new prison cell in this country, according to the Parliamentary Budget Officer. Now, instead of investing in getting at the roots of poverty, mental illness, and addiction, instead of focusing on a comprehensive pan-Canadian job strategy, and by the way, rolling over for the oil and gas industry isn't a cross-Canada jobs program. This government wants to spend close to $3 billion a year locking more people up, providing fewer programs to rehabilitate them, all the while draining our public coffers of precious resources that could actually truly create safer streets. Indeed, prison costs are up 86% since the Conservatives took power while the crime rate continues to fall to its lowest levels since the 1970s. We have a government here that has racked up the biggest fiscal deficit in the history of Canada. And instead of being smart with taxpayers' money, they play politics and let their dated right-wing ideology continue to craft bad public policy. For example, a single new security cell is going to cost $260,000 to build, a low security cell. A medium security cell, $400,000. A maximum security cell, $600,000. For goodness sakes, even the annual cost of an inmate in a community correctional center right now is over $85,000 a year. Does this make fiscal sense? As the income cap gets wider and wider in this country, the government hectors Canadians about belt tightening while they spend on a prison expansion scheme that both the Canadian Bar Association and the Canadian Civil Liberties Association, among many others, have serious concerns about. But of course, this government doesn't actually want to hear what Canadians think about this omnibus bill. Well, if they did, they wouldn't have limited debate on this. Bill C-10 packages up 9 government bills from the previous parliament and presents them to the House and to Canadians as one whopping bill, and then says, accept it all, without any conversation, without any debate. But with the motion that passed yesterday morning, Canadians in this House will only be able to debate for a period of, less than 2 hours for each of the 9 bills. Now, for a government that was elected to bring more transparency, more accountability to this place, they are, in fact, bringing less, and the action of limiting debate on this huge and outrageously expensive bill is the last one more example of this lack of transparency. And it is too bad. I mean, Canadians deserve to have C-10 aired to its fullest. Experts say that mandatory minimum sentences do not work for reducing drug use, tackling organized crime, or making our communities safer. Indeed. The measures contained in this bill, for example, will not make it easier for law enforcement agencies to get to the organized crime bosses who run the drug trade, who we need to bring in, who we need to incarcerate. Indeed, one of the most effective ways to promote public safety is the successful rehabilitation and reintegration back into society of offenders. Our federal prison system lacks the programs to deal with this effectively. This legislation does not deal with this issue in any kind of real way. Now, indeed, Madam Speaker, we do not oppose everything in this bill. As we saw yesterday in this House, my honourable colleague from Windsor-Tecumseh tabled a motion that would have expedited the passing of elements of this bill that were in the last Parliament, known as Bill C-54. This section seeks to protect children from exploitation and sexual abuse. In fact, the government has adopted measures in this section of Bill C-10 put forward by the NDP in private members' bills. So it's too bad that this government would rather play politics than move quickly on parts of this bill that could get unanimous support in this House, like these measures to protect our children. In fact, immediately after voting down the motion that would have sent that part of the bill to the Senate within 48 hours, government members proceeded with statements on the importance of the very measure they had just voted against putting on the fast track. As I said, there are things in this bill which we do agree with, which we could find common ground with the government on, but they're not really interested in doing that. The government's decision to limit debate keeps a measure of ideological cynicism onto what should be a very, very thorough, very serious examination. This bill is too costly, and it won't make our streets and communities safer. We on the NDP side of the House have been prepared to work with the government to quickly pass the measures that will protect children and to fix measures that won't work. It's too bad this government wants to play politics and games with the safety of some of the most vulnerable in our society. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Questions and comments? The Honorable Member for Calgary Northeast.
Well, thank you, Madam Speaker. I heard my colleague from the opposite very carefully. And let me tell him what I heard in Calgary Northeast. I got a chance to talk to a couple of offenders who had been in the jail for a couple times and for a few months each time. I did ask one question, one specific question to each of them, that what about if you had to spend minimum 2 years for the same offense, you spent 2 months. And they said, we would not have done it. Oh. That's what the debt transit. And I heard the member. He talked about the cost, and he talked about the debate. First of all, these bills have been debated in this House in the past very, very extensively. Now, coming out to the cost, but it's so unfortunate, Madam Speaker, that I have not heard a line about supporting the victim. So my question is, why can't they stop playing politics and do the right thing, stand up for the victims and support this bill and make a change for once?
The Honourable Member for Davenport.
Well, the fact of the matter, Madam Speaker, is that 77,000 fewer reported crimes in 2010 than 2009. 2010 crime rates the lowest since the 1970s. And yet the cost of prisons are up 86% since the Conservative government took over. This is the new math of this Parliament, and Canadians are scratching their heads, and we are wondering why this government seeks to, you know, spend money in such a fashion without fulsome debate in this House on the bill that we have before us.
Questions and comments?
Questions and comments?
The Honourable Member for Etobicoke North.
Honourable Member, Canada's prisons are home to an increasing number of offenders with mental health disorders, ranging from antisocial personality disorder through to schizophrenia, and offenders may also be addicted to alcohol or drugs. We are seeing criminalization of the mentally ill. A recent report from the Office of the Correctional Investigator shows the number of people in federal prisons with mental illnesses has nearly doubled in the past decade, while the incarceration rate barely budged. I'm wondering what solutions the Honourable Member would suggest to treat people with mental illness who run into difficulty with the law, often because of a lack of a national mental health strategy and poorly funded, disorganized, and fragmented community mental health services.
The Honourable Member for Davenport.
Well, I'd like to thank my honourable friend for that excellent question, and it's true. Law enforcement agencies across Canada have been saying for years that they need the resources to properly deal with the issue of mental health, and we're seeing this time and time again, and anecdotally across Canada, that when law enforcement agencies have that training, many situations that previously resulted in tragic outcomes don't. So it's incumbent on us to provide for law enforcement agencies those tools they need to learn more about mental health, to understand the issue, and to understand that this is an illness and it's not criminal behavior.
Questions and comments? L'honorable député de...
The Honourable Member for Repentigny. Thank you, Madam Speaker. As a father myself, I find it completely unacceptable for the government to say that it's responsible, hiding behind pedophilia, saying that there are other aspects in the bill which are laudable, and they're saying that we don't want to support their bill. No, that's not correct. Is it acceptable to hide behind one point in order to try and push through others in such an irresponsible way? That's my question.
Honourable Member for Davenport, a brief
response. Okay, well thank you, Madam Speaker. Thank you to my honourable colleague for the question. And in fact, this is one of the problems we have with this bill. Really, it's a cynical move on the part of the government to hide the problematic parts of this bill inside an omnibus bill so that we can't as parliamentarians, as representatives of the Canadian public, so we can't properly debate them. I think we all think this is a very serious problem here.
Resuming.